Okay, welcome everybody. Today we'll be starting on basics of Lightroom, especially the library module and the how to import into library module. Because Lightroom as such is a program where there's quite a lot of confusion as far as the overall the look of the Lightroom is concerned, because it doesn't really match that of any of either a Windows or a Mac software. So what usually when you open Lightroom for the first time, you'll be facing with, you know, this particular screen. It's pretty daunting. You know, what should I do? Luckily, they have added this particular thing. Now, I have started a Lightroom with the new catalog. That's why you get this. So when you install Lightroom for the first time, what happens is it will go through a few of the intro slides, which are which will tell you about Lightroom and different modules and etc. But after that, you'll end up in this particular screen. So this screen is daunting at first, but it's especially useful when you try to organize files. Now, this is a library module. It consists of several small modules on both right, left, as well as bottom. And then there are other menus like the develop module, where you'll be doing individual file development. And then you have map module, book module, slideshow module, print module, and web module. Now let me go to annotate and get that mouse. Yeah. Now we can see my mouse clearly. So that's why I just changed that to annotate. Now, coming to different modules, they can be both controlled using mouse or keyboard. Now, initial catalog, when you create, it will be saved in the C folder, C drive. Under C drive, under pictures folder, which in Windows, it's hidden somewhere in between your user data, and within that, there'll be a folder called a picture folder. So within that picture folder, it will be created. That means as the file size increases, your catalog will also grow up. And as it grows up, it will start occupying your C drive. So ideally, when you try to import something, it is better to start off your catalog in a drive which is different from C drive. Ideally, what you can do is file, create new catalog, and then it will give you a dialog box where you want to create a catalog. So you can choose any one of the drives and then create a catalog there. And then Lightroom will ask to reboot, and then it will open up that catalog. So you need not get stuck with the default catalog which is there in the picture folder. I suggest you go to any other drives and then start. Now, in case of Lightroom, it will work everywhere. It will work whether it's an external drive or an internal drive. So if you have a faster external drive, for example, if you have a newer type of SSD drives, you can use them to store your catalog. Or if you have an internal SSD drive, which is faster than your HDD drive, that's a better place where you want to store this catalog. Ideally, catalog, and along with that, there are some preview files which are next to the catalog. Those should be in an area where hard disk is faster. So if you have a faster hard disk, for example, if you have a spinning hard disk, it comes with the 5600 RPM, 7000 RPM, and 9000 RPM. So it's better to go to a 9000 RPM if it is a spinning hard disk. SSDs are harder, faster than spinning hard disk. So if you have even a small SSD, for example, 256 and 512 SSDs are quite cheap now. It's better suppose you want to upgrade a computer, don't really bother about upgrading anything else other than RAM and SSD. Your computer will be as fast as the latest generation computer, because Intel or AMD for that matter, both of them haven't really done a great thing as far as the processors are concerned. 7th generation to 10th generation Intel is almost exactly the same thing. What they have done is more on the gaming side, but not on these actual photo editing software. So whether you are running Photoshop or Lightroom, trying to get a better amount of RAM and better hard disk, like a faster SSD drive, is good enough. And in fact, even in SSDs, there are extremely fast SSDs and just slower SSDs. Even the slowest SSD, which is very cheap nowadays, it's almost the price of a hard disk. So those ones, which you can get it in, say, a 512 GB configuration, is perfect as far as running both Windows as well as programs like Lightroom. Now, your original files, you can save them in an external hard disk or a regular spinning hard disk. So with that introduction, let me start showing you different parts of Lightroom. Those of you who already use Lightroom, this will be sort of a redundant, but you might realize that a few of the shortcuts which I'm showing might be interesting. For example, if you want to have the central area, which is the library, only to your use, and you don't want any of the modules, all you need to do is press Shift and Tab. So then everything disappears except the central console. When you press Shift Tab all over again, all the modules will come back. So if you're working with a single picture and you want to concentrate only on the picture and you don't want any of the modules surrounding it, then all you need to do is Shift and Tab. And Shift and Tab again will bring them back. If you press just Tab, the right and left modules go off, and what's at the bottom, that's called a film strip, that still remains. So it's better you learn these keyboard shortcuts. And it's very easy to find out where the keyboard shortcuts is. You don't have to go on the web and find out. Just go to help. And then you have keyboard shortcuts here. And shortcut for that is a control and forward slash. Forward slash is the one which is next to the shift key. So control and forward slash, if you press, which are very close, control and forward slash is very, very close. So you can press those keys and then you'll get the same dialog box. That is this one. So you get the shortcuts. Now these shortcuts are different at different module. If you are in the develop module, the shortcuts are different. If you go to library module, that is also different. So if you can go to library module, again, the shortcut keys are same, but the shortcuts are different in library module and develop module. In fact, the only two modules which you'll be using frequently will be the library, where you sort out the pictures, and the develop module, where you'll be developing a single picture. So that's about the shortcuts. Now, let me go through each one of them as we start importing files. Now, without files imported, the catalog, even though my computer has got a lot of files, the Lightroom cannot read a file. So you can't go like any other program, like file, open, and that sort of thing. So the first dialog what you get is new catalog or open catalog. Open catalog will already open whatever existing catalog you have, or a new catalog. So this is a new catalog which I opened. There are no files here. Now let me import the file. So either I can go into import dialog from the file, or I can press on the import key here. So when I press on the import key, it will start opening up the dialog box. This is a totally a different dialog box from the Lightroom's usual dialog box. This is a sort of a inbuilt import dialog box. Now, if you have already a card which is inserted, for example, in my case, a card is inserted into my M drive. So it already knows that it is a DCIM folder, and it goes and shows you all the photographs which are available. So I can import this particular photograph in a various way. So now there are three options at the top, which allows me to import these photographs. So one is called the copy. The second is called the move. and the third is the ad. And when you are using external hard disk, external card or external drive or a pen drive, which are removable, you won't be getting any other dialog box other than copy. If you import something from, let's say, that desktop, so I can go to the top and go to the desktop. So if I want to import something from here, then I'll get copy, move, and add. So I get add, copy, and move. But when I use a pen drive, I get only copy. That means I can copy from the pen drive to another hard disk. So I need to do that way so that, you know, I can't copy from a pen drive to a pen drive. So it has to go from a pen drive, which is a removable drive, to a non-removable drive, which can be internal hard disk or an external hard disk. So the option of copy and move is that when you choose for copy, it copies from drive A to drive B, but files will be remaining in both the places. So drive A also will have drive, the files, like the pen drive which I'm using or a card which I'm using, that will have the files. The files won't be erased. And my hard disk, where I'm going to point out that that is the destination part here. So that part I have to specify where it has to go. So that particular destination will also have the same amount of files. So I can have the files there as well as files here. So that's basically what copy stands for. When you choose move, for example, if I go into desktop and I choose some of the files here, so then it will show move. What move does is it copies the files from my desktop to my destination, wherever I am telling, plus it deletes these files. So these files are basically going from point A to point B, and then they get deleted. So that's what move is. My sincere recommendation is never ever use this particular feature. So if you want to use copy first, and then go manually and delete it. Because I have seen many of the disasters as far as the computer copying is concerned is basically using a move. Now this applies to normal move also whenever we are using in computer. When you copy a file from a point A to point B, always use copy, never ever use move. Now coming to add. So Dheeraj had asked one question that, you see, he has two backups, backup A and backup B. And Venkat also has asked a question. Basically, the question is, he has already arranged files. He has about 200 odd different folders, which he had created much before he plans to migrate to Lightroom. Now, these folders are all named. For example, if he has gone to Rangantittu in December 2018, that will be marked as a Rangantittu December 2018. Now, when he tries to do anything like copy or move, it copies to a point which is separate from where he has organized. Now, in his case, he has already organized files. This is a case for many people, because what really happens is you would have done your photo organization and photo editing in different softwares. For example, many of the old timers are still stuck in Photoshop, because they think that Photoshop is a better photo editing software. It's not. It is a very destructive editing software. Unfortunately, at that time, before the Lightroom really came into existence, there was nothing available. So everybody started using only Photoshop. The Lightroom was developed after digital cameras really came into existence. So these the Lightroom is a product from Adobe, basically to help photographers so that they can get this stuff and develop them indestructibly. So that's the main advantage of a Lightroom. Whatever developing, whatever editing what you are doing on these files, the files are not disturbed. The editing is kept inside the catalog. And nothing else is spoiled. And what you see inside the Lightroom are basically previews. So, and one more thing, which is exclusively for Lightroom, is that in the dialog box anywhere, you don't see a save option. The files are saved at any given time. Whatever small changes you do, it's already saved inside the catalog box. So the main idea of Lightroom is basically you do a development or editing. They call it development because, you know, the Lightroom basically came, the word came from the darkroom days. So we used to develop in the darkroom using those film days. So now the newer version is the Lightroom. So in Lightroom, you will be developing files. It's exactly same as the editing files. Now, coming back to add. So the add option, what it does is you have already organized files in the in your computer, in your hard disk, in your non-removable drive, not the removable drive. So when you get it from a pen drive or a card reader or a card from a camera, you won't get that option at all. This option is only available if you already have the files in your computer, in your external hard disk or an internal hard disk, any one of them. At that time, what happens is you add the information about those photographs into Lightroom. So the Lightroom knows where exactly those files are. And using that information, you can do the development of that particular file. So let me do a copy because, you know, as of now, I haven't done anything. This is a new, fresh, new catalog which is open. So when I do a copy or a move, I get this dialog box telling what to do. So one of it is build smart previews. In the later webinars, I'll talk about how what are smart previews and what are its uses and how we can really use these smart previews. But as of now, don't bother about smart previews. There is also another option called minimal previews, embedded and sidecar previews, standard previews, and 1:1 previews. I'll explain each one of them because they are important. Minimal means it calculates your size of the screen. For example, if you have a full HD screen, it will create a preview which is 1920 into 1080. That's a full HD screen. If you choose only embedded and sidecar files, that means when your camera shoots a RAW file or a JPEG file, there is already a preview built into it. JPEG is itself is a preview. Inside the RAW file, there is a JPEG file which is embedded. So that embedded file is what is embedded and sidecar file. The third one is a standard. Standard preview is it creates a larger format preview, which is about twice the size of your screen. And then last one is called 1:1 preview, which is 100% size of the preview. Now, this will tax your machine when it's imported. You can do that later. So either you choose a minimal preview or you choose embedded and sidecar, one of the two. So either you can go for the minimal, which is the default one, or embedded and sidecar. That means whatever your camera has already created, that particular preview is what is to be done when you are imported. Now, if you choose any one of the standard or 1:1 preview, what happens is your import gets delayed. Import is slow. Now, if you don't mind that import is slower, then you can choose any one of these. What I usually do is I leave it at embedded and sidecar so that I can see how the camera has really taken this particular picture. And then later, just before development, just before editing, I build a larger size of preview. Now, building a larger size of preview is important because otherwise you won't be able to browse the file. What really happens is if you don't build the preview inside the Lightroom, the file takes some time for it to build up a preview. So if I go from one file to another file, now as of now, I have not imported. This is what I'm seeing is just this import dialog box giving me the preview. But as I move from one to another, if my machine is slow, then it will start giving me lag. So for that, I have to really build a preview. So building preview is important. So you can choose either minimal preview or embedded and sidecar, one of these two. Now, coming to building smart preview, don't do this now. Then don't import suspected duplicates. This is very important setting which you have to tick. The reason is, what we usually do is we shoot once, import into Lightroom, then without formatting the card, we go out, shoot again, then try to import again. Then say after 2 days, we again go back, shoot some more and import it. Lightroom remembers the older imports, so it doesn't re-import those files. So that's what this don't import suspected duplicates. So that's an important option. Leave it checked. All other things you need not. Now, make a second copy is an option which where it allows you to create another copy. So one copy will go to my main computer, the second copy will go to this particular computer. But unfortunately, this is not a correct way of doing this. The reason is all these files will be just dumped there in that particular folder. They are not arranged like what I'm doing here. So what I usually do is untick this, make a second copy option. Then I use a secondary software, like a syncing software, which basically syncs a file in the exact way, like cloning software. You can think of a cloning software. If you don't know what it is, you refer to my earlier webinar, a Zoom webinar, where I had talked extensively on how to backup files. You can get a YouTube link, which is the recorded version of that particular webinar is there. The last Saturday, we spoke on this particular topic. It covers, I think, what every photographer as well as computer expert should really know about backing up your software. Now, coming to this option, the next option, that is file renaming. You can rename the files. While importing, you can rename the files. Also, you can rename the files later once you import. So both the options are there. And when you rename the file, you can give a different name. For example, you can give a separate file name, or if you want to have a file name plus sequence, you can give. You can give a model number. You can give a sequence of numbers. You can give an original name. So you need not be stuck with that, you know, DSC something, something, or IMG something, that sort of numbers, which basically your computer gives. You can rename them as you want. So that particular option, like, for example, I'll just show you how it is. So you can give a camera model number. This is what I usually use. So this is a Sony A7 R4 camera, and the date of capture, which is in the year, month, day, and then image number, which is taken up from the particular file which is there. For example, if it is IMG 14793, this will be the 14793 of that IMG. Now, at the same time, you can also add in sequences. Like the first file will be called 1, then 2, 3, 4, and the sequence number. So you can play around with this particular option. So you can change the file name. You can change the date, month. You can change a year, format. You can give all other criteria. For example, you can also add focal length if you want. You can add the lens details. You can add ISO number. It's not required, but if you are really that crazy, you can add all those information right in the file name itself. So that is an option while importing it does. And the advantage in Lightroom is when it's importing it, it already does that job, so you need not do it again. So suppose you are consistently renaming a file in a particular way, I think this is the best option. It doesn't tax the import speed as such. So you can just leave it as it is. And then you can if your camera is persistently giving some sort of a tint or a tinge of color, and you want to add that particular tinge of color later in post-processing, you can add that particular preset. I'll be talking, you know, while I'm doing some webinar on develop module, I'll show you how a preset can be done. You can also go back to my Lightroom webinar, which was done where we had a question and answer where I showed how to create a preset. So you can create such presets, and you can allow those presets to be imported. So the advantage of this is you need not go into the developing at all. So suppose you have a particular look you want to give to that those particular files, you create a preset, just leave the preset. While importing, they'll add the preset straight away, and then they get imported. And lastly, it comes to a destination where you basically you want to import these files. So that is where the importing part comes in. So you can give a particular place, so import into a subfolder and give the name for the subfolder. So this was captured during my lockdown period. So I give a name called a curfew capture. I don't want to name it as a date. I just want it into one folder. And the folder will be somewhere here under the, let's see, it's under photos. Yeah, directly under photos. So I want it there. So I can also do it under 2020. That will give you a better option. So in this case, I'm just going to put it under the photos. So when I press import, what happens is all these files will get imported into this new Lightroom catalog. So this is, it's importing now. So you can see all the files getting appeared in the library module, which was earlier not having any files because the catalog was empty. Now, you might have seen this, these files already have a rating and a color combination around it. Now, what I really did before this was I had exported it from my earlier catalog. My job, whenever I import something, what I usually do is I cull these photographs. And so initially when they come, they don't have any ratings. So culling is an important task. So before culling, what I usually do is I build a preview. So if you are not imported with the preview, it is better to build a preview after you import everything. Now, after you import all the files, what you have to do is go into library, choose under previews, and build 1:1 previews. This will take some time, so allow it to build a preview. You can do it immediately after import, or if you are not developing immediately, which I recommend you to do, you can do it, do the development or editing little after importing. I usually spend about a week or 10 days, unless that particular photograph is urgent photograph. I usually allow my mind to settle down for at least a week or 10 days before I edit photographs. So what usually happens is whenever we go on the field and capture insects like these, when we come back, we have the same mental setup as that of capture. So when you really go and try to edit something, you find, okay, you are still in that particular mental setup. So now, after about 5 to 6 days, you would have changed the whole attitude. You would have changed how you wanted to really edit those photographs. So then it's easier for you to do editing. So just before editing a set of photographs, what I do is I go to that particular folder. Now in this case, it has imported a file. So this is my curfew of capture. So that is a folder. And that folder contains about 55 photographs, which I just imported. So now I have come out of the import dialog box. This is a separate dialog box which shows a catalog files. So this is a library. The library has got different views. On your left-hand side, you see the catalog. So this is a fresh catalog, so I don't have many photographs. If I go into my original catalog, which I use in this computer, so this is the catalog. That catalog, if I open, there are about 8 lakh photographs in that. That doesn't lag. The number of photographs doesn't really make any difference. Now, let me come here. There are about 55 photographs. That comes under what are called all photographs selection. Then there is all synced photograph. You can sync photograph with your cloud collection. Then you can create what are called a quick collection. I'll go through what this quick collection is. And then the previous import is the just before this particular episode, the import, which as of now, it's only 55 photographs. It's the same as that of the total photographs. Suppose, say you import again now next time and you import about five photographs. So your previous import will have that five photographs. And in fact, the Lightroom will be showing you the previous import. After you import, the first thing what it shows you is the previous import. It doesn't show you all photographs. So if I import some more photographs again, so it will only show you previous import. And if you want to go to all photographs, you have to go to all the photographs and click on that. And then only you can see. So if I had imported 55 photographs and then it imports another five photographs, so 60 photographs will be here. And many a times, if the preview is not created, you'll get this sort of, you know, empty this thing. So just click on that, the preview gets created instantaneously. Because Lightroom, as soon as you try to open and look through the photograph, it'll create previews. But what preview it creates is basically a static preview. It doesn't create a 1:1 particular preview. It creates a standard preview. Sorry, not a static preview, it's a standard preview. Now, these are not original photos. What you're seeing here is a previewed photograph of an original photo. So suppose you have a RAW file at the background. This is a sort of a JPEG file, which is there inside the catalog. Next to the catalog, there is a folder called a preview folder. Within that folder, these files exist. So when you're seeing these files, and when you expand it to full size, it basically shows you the preview so that it is faster. So it's not going to redo the preview from the RAW files. But if you do see any of the changes, it will again redo the file from the RAW file. So it will take a little bit of lag, but it's worth it. Now coming, after you have imported the files, you can tag these files. So there are several ways of tagging these files. Tagging is basically for you to decide which is a good file, which is a bad photo, and that sort of thing. So what you can do you can go through the library module. And library module has got several settings. Let me expand the library module. Again, the key is what I mentioned earlier, Shift and Tab. So when you press Shift and Tab, everything gets hidden except the photograph. And then you have a toolbar at the bottom. So this toolbar also gives you a different viewing options. So this viewing option is basically to show all the photographs in the library. So the shortcut key for that is G, G for grid, grid view. So what it is showing is the various grids within that the photographs are really shown. Then you have expanded view or the E key. So when I press E, so expanded view comes, that's a single view like this. This is a loop view, they call it. But since the shortcut key is E, I associate with the expanded view. So I can really make out that it's the E. Now this is not a full zoom. It fills the screen, that's what it is. So full zoom, you use a mouse or you can use a Z key, which will do a full zoom and show you the photograph. Now, the next one, let's say that you have two photographs which are identical. Now, let's say that this and this, these are the two photographs which are the same flies, but in a different pose. So I want to compare which pose is better. So I want to see them side by side. So that is where this side by side option comes. So that's a third one. It's called a compare view, where I can compare one file with another file. So shortcut key is compare C. So when I press C, so both the files come together. And the advantage here is when I zoom in, both the files get zoomed in. So I can see whichever file I want using this zoom option. Now this is especially useful when you are doing a portrait photograph or any other photograph where, you know, not like flies. Flies, they keep on running around, so you won't get identical view. But many of the times when we take a photograph of humans, we take multiple photographs so that, you know, you can avoid those blinky eyes or the eyes which are closed. So you want to compare one photograph with another photograph. You can use this, the view, which is the compare view. You can expand it to a larger size so that you can show them. Now, okay, you can see for yourself where person has blinked, where he has closed his eyes. All those things can be really made up. And you can use, suppose you have multiple similar type of files, which are basically one after the other. This is the main select file, and this is the subsequent file. So you can keep on moving them. So one will be in static, the other will keep on moving. Now, in my case, these are all different sets of files. So you won't get identical file. Anyway, that's a view which is called a compare view. And lastly, you have a face identification view. It's a people view. That's only useful if you have persons in that. So advantage in that particular view is that you can survey a lot of people, and then you can use them to show exactly who is who, and you can tag them. So tagging is similar to that what we use in Facebook. Then there is also another view called a survey view. This is useful when you want to select, say, 5 or 6 different photographs. So let me choose the photograph. So I select one, select another. What I'm doing here is I'm pressing my control key and selecting the photographs. So when I do a control and click, all the photographs which have clicked using control key are selected. So when I go into the survey mode, only those photographs which I've selected come there. So I can eliminate some few of the photographs. For example, I think that, okay, there are two of this, so I'll remove them. I didn't like this lava, I'll remove them. So I can get only 5 of these photographs. So when I go back to the grid, only those 5 photographs are selected. So that is advantage, especially when you want to select from a large bunch of photographs and you want only 4 or 5 photographs for an album or for a printing. That's how you use. So that is a survey mode. So there are 4 different modes. Let me go through again. First is the grid mode, G. Then expanded mode, E. Then compare mode is C. And the last one is a survey mode, which has got a keyboard shortcut of N. I don't know why survey mode has N, but at least you can choose that particular survey mode option. And when you hover a mouse over that, you get expanded view, which shows basically that mouse where it is. So that's different views, modes. And if I want all the modules back, all I need to do is begin, press Shift and Tab. Now all the modules will come back. Now, you can arrange these files, you can rename these files. So let's say that I have selected few of the files, and if I want to rename them, shortcut key like that of Windows, the rename shortcut key is F2. So if I press F2, I get the same dialog box here. So I can give a different custom name sequences. I can give a customs, this was earlier I had done for Solar Eclipse, where I gave a name, so that still remaining. So now I can say this is lockdown capture. And then I can give a sequence. So say okay. Now if you notice, whatever file which I've selected, now it got the name lockdown capture. See, this is the third file which I selected that gave lockdown capture 3. So that is the advantage of renaming of how you want. Now this is especially useful for wedding photographers. See, what happens is when you shoot, they will be shooting around 300 to 400 photographs. But when you're giving to the client, you'll be giving only about, say, 20 or 30 photographs. So it's better to sequentially name them from 1 to 30 than giving, a photograph 3, 8, 7, and missing few of the in-between photographs because they were not good. The client will ask, to show those particular photographs. So better to, rename them sequentially so that your first photograph and last photograph will not have any blank numbers or names in there. So that's the advantage of renaming them. So you can rename them while importing. Also, you can rename them after importing. You can also add keywords. So one of the advantage of keywording is you can create keywording, you can create a list of keywording. So it's pretty easy to type in the keywords. So you select all these photographs. Let's say that the photograph says, okay, this is all lockdown captures. Then I know, okay, this is a jewel bug. So I'll deselect all the files. So how do you deselect? You can go to another file and just select on that. Then it will deselect all the files. So this is my jewel bug. So I can say that this is, you can put a comma. When you put a comma, you're creating another keyword. So that's the keyword which you're creating. So the advantage later, you can go into the search bar, which is called a library filter, and select all the photographs and go to a text and then say that you want jewel bug. See, it's already selected that particular photograph. So you can go back and select that particular photograph. Now, I'll go through this filter later. So you can create keywords, and those keywords also will be exported. So softwares which support such an export, for example, your Flickr account, that supports keywords. Unfortunately, Instagram as well as Facebook don't support keywords. Flickr, Google Photos, several other good program photo sites allow you to add these keywords. And if you are into stock photography, the keywording is the in thing. So if you are also trying to organize your files within your whole setup, see what happens is over years, you'll keep on accumulating quite a lot of photographs. For example, my photographs from 2004 onwards, just the digital photographs are nearly about 8 lakhs. So if somebody asks me about, let's say that he wants about jewel bugs, which I've shot in somewhere in 2014, it's very difficult for me to search. But if I added that keyword into the search, I can easily pick up. All I have to do is go to all photographs in my selection, go to text, and then pick up jewel. For that, you have to have only one single catalog. If you have multiple catalogs, it can't search. For example, I just created a new catalog for this particular webinar. It can't search my older catalog. So even though I have among four catalogs, these two are just sample catalogs which I keep playing around. This is my main catalog called ILR catalog. So that particular catalog has got all my photographs. So if I go there and then I search, it will give me umpteen number of results for this jewel bug. All the jewel bugs which have photographs till now, it'll pick up, because I meticulously keyword every insect which I post or which I capture. It takes some amount of discipline as well as time, but it's well worth it on the long run. I can also create what are called collections. Collections are virtual folders. So other than renaming them, I can also create a collection here. I'll give you one example of just a collection here. For example, let me create one collection called I can name this collection. I'll just call it Zoom Webinar Collection. Now, if I had selected few photographs, I can include those photographs straight away into the collection. Since I've not included, I think I've included only one photograph. Let me untick this. Let me create. So as of now, only one photograph is selected. So that comes into that. I can always go back into my all photographs. I can choose. Let's say I'll choose this, and drag into this particular capture. Now I have 5 photographs. So if you go back to the folder or original files, you will notice that none of those files are moved. But I have created a virtual organization inside the Lightroom, and this is not visible externally. Now this has got a lot of advantages. Let me give an example of a wedding photographer. Normally, wedding photographers, what they do is, they take photographs, they come back, and once they are in the particular, once they take photographs, and then they come back to their computer, they'll just dump everything to one single folder, and then they give a bride's and a groom's name for that particular folder. Then they'll work on that. They'll create another folder called work folder, where they'll be copying all the files which they have worked. Then they want to show it to the client. So they create another folder, and then they copy these files to the client folder. And the client folder, after that, they'll show it to the client. The client will select about 30 or 40 photographs. That will finally go into the print. So they'll create one more folder called album. Now, what really happens on the hard disk, there are four folders are created, each containing the same file again and again and again. Whereas, if you're using a collection, the advantage of this collection is that the files are not repeated. This is sort of a virtual folder, but the files are not repeated. There is only one original file. The Lightroom just assumes that, you know, those files are also here. They are also, you can also create one more folder. Let's say that I'll create one folder. Just, this is called a collection, not a folder. This collection is called, say, printing. I can add these files. I can add one more file from here to the printing. Or I can add all the files. So now the printing will have four files, and my earlier capture will have five files. Now I decide, okay, I don't want this particular file here. I can delete that. So those four files are gone, but they're not really actually deleted. They're just deleted from this collection. So that is the advantage of a collection, where you can organize them as you want, but the original files are not deleted. So that's important, because when I delete from a collection, it just goes out of the collection. That's all. The file is not actually deleted, because it's a virtual collection. It's a virtual link to that original file. If I do the same delete function on this particular photograph, you'll get a dialog box. See, you get this dialog box. Now, let me explain. This is a very complicated dialog box for many people who are starting for the first time. There are two options. There is one delete from disk, and then there is remove. Now, these two give totally different results. When I say delete from disk, what it does is it removes from the Lightroom catalog, as well as it sends it to the recycle bin. So it deletes actual file. Whereas if I choose remove, what it does is it just removes from the Lightroom catalog, but the original file still remains. So if you go back to import, you can re-import that particular file back into the Lightroom catalog. So that is the advantage of, you know, not deleting straight away, but giving you this particular warning and then allowing you to decide. So for most cases, you choose only remove, because that's the safest way. Your original file is saved. If you say delete from disk, your file goes from the Lightroom as well as it goes away from your original files also. Still, you have one more option, going back to recycle bin and recovering the file. So your original file can be recovered. But over time, if you forget to do that, even the recycle bin gets cleared, then you will lose the original file. So as far as possible, you stick with remove. So this happens only when you are in the actual folder. But when you are in the collection, if you want to remove some of the collection, you can just remove that just pressing the delete key. So those files are gone. Then you can also mark these files. For example, I can say that this is a very good file. So I can give 4 stars to this particular file. This is sort of an average file. I give 3 stars. This is a very nice file. I give 4 stars. So this way, you can rank these files depending on which amount of files you want to keep and which files you want to delete. So many a times we shoot like machine gun. We have a lot of files. It's prudent to always reduce the number of files to bare minimum. Remove all the files where there is motion blur, where there is a handshake, or somebody has photobombed those particular files. So all those cases, you just remove those files straight away when you are doing a culling. So that's where the library really shines. Library allows you to organize files copy files from one place to another. It can also allow you, in fact, you can copy, you can create a new folder here in the folder itself. And I advise, whenever you copy or move a file which is already imported into Lightroom, do that from inside Lightroom. So let's say that I'm in this particular drive. So I want to create a new folder here. So I can create a new folder, add a folder, and I can give a name. Like, let's say that I can go to desktop and I can create webinar. So now there is a folder called webinar. Now I can copy these files to that particular folder. So I can create new folder. I can import new folder, for example. Let me show. So that's a file I created. So I want to move the file from this to here. So it will give a warning telling that I'm moving the file here in this case. So I can say yes. Now webinar folder, which I created, has got one file. So this is actually, I have full, I've moved the file. So if I go into Explorer and find out in my webinar folder on my desktop, this particular file would have already come. So if you want to move something, move it from a particular folder inside the Lightroom. Don't move it using your Explorer window. Or if you are in the Mac, don't use your Finder window and then copy files from one place to another. Do it from inside the Lightroom. So that is the advantage of using Lightroom to move files from one another. So if you have many drives, you can copy file from one place to another place. You can do that from inside the, so you can organize the files. Even though you import it to a wrong place, you can organize the files later, going into the library and dragging and dropping them wherever you feel. So you can create new folders, you can add new folders. So all those are possible. But that they move actual files. Whereas if I do collections, those are all virtual files. Now, I'll show you one more option inside the collection, what's called a smart collection. So smart collection is a collection based on some criteria. So let's say that I mark this as 3 stars. I mark this as 4 star. And this one has 2 stars. Now I can create a smart collection which all have 4-star collection. So if I can go back here and create a smart collection, and there it'll ask you the ratings of that particular photograph is more than 4 stars. So I can say 4 stars or plus. I can also add another criteria. For example, all that rating which has got a color, its label color is red. So I can have multiple choices here. I can always say that, you know, it is short from let's say that camera info, the camera which has got Sony in it. So I think didn't pick up this particular thing. Let me go back to the, let me remove this particular. So save dupes. Let's see the. So this is a smart collection because it picked up all those where I have named them as a 4-star files. Plus it, they also have a red color. Now, how do you get this red color and yellow color and other things? Star ratings comes from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You can use the keyboard. So when you press 0, it goes off. So when I press, let's say that this file, if I press 1 star, 2 star, 3 star, 4 star, 5 star. If I want to change it, press whatever. Let's say that I want to make it 2-star, I can just go back to 2. So whichever star rating I press from 0, if I want to remove that, I can press 0. the star rating goes off. So if I want this as 4-star, just press 4. Now, if I go into 6, that is after the 5-star, there is no 6-star. That is the red what you are seeing. 6 is basically red. If I press it again, you see that red is gone. Now press it again, the red comes back. If I press 7, you see that yellow label comes back. Press 7 again, the yellow label goes back. So the labels, color labels start from 6, 7, 8, 9 are color labels. 1 to 5 are star ratings. So you can give both star rating plus color labels. So I can give 4 for this. I can give color labels. So I can remove all the color labels by, let's say that I don't want all these red color labels which I gave together. So I can go back, press 6. All the color labels are gone. So now the color labels are vanished. So you want to have, you know, color labels for few. You can have different color labels for different purposes. For example, those I want to post it in for I want to print those. I'll mark them as red labeled. Those I want to send to Facebook, I'll give them as a yellow label. Those I want to send it to my friend, I can give a green label. So on and so forth. So you can label them. This is only internally labeled. The files actually don't get any of these colors. So don't bother, you know, just because you're putting a red color, that file will be reddish. Nothing of that sort. That all comes under the develop module. In the library module, you are basically coloring them just for your understanding of that particular file. And you can use a smart collection, which basically goes by the criteria. Whereas if you go for the actual collection, the same, the dumb collection, you can say, because one is called a smart collection, this can say dumb collection, which is basically a virtual folder. So you can drag them and you can save it. And you can also want to sync with the cloud, because see, Lightroom comes as a cloud planning. So if you purchase a cloud plan from Adobe, basically you get Photoshop as well as Photoshop as well as Lightroom, and you will also get a 20 GB of space. So in that 20 GB of space, you can upload few of the files which you can access from anywhere. So you can go to any computer, you can use your mobile device, and you can access that particular file. Now, let me stop here. If you have any questions, I'll answer. And then we'll go back to two of the questions which I got. One is from Dheeraj, another is from Venkat. I'll answer those questions. Let me stop the share. Let me go back to the... So if you have any questions, you let me know. Okay, please show an easy way to delete multiple files from a folder in an easy way. Vinod is asking that question. It's pretty easy. Let me go back to the screen. Let's assume that these files are in the different folders. See, inside the Lightroom, you don't get the folder hierarchy. The folder hierarchy is only at the side. So if you go to the topmost folder, now, for example, if you go under all photographs folder, that shows you all the photographs within the Lightroom. Right. Now, let me go back and reiterate what I was telling. Inside the Lightroom, there is no folder hierarchy when you go through all photographs. That will show you all the folders. For example, in my Lightroom main, not the one which I'm using for the webinar now, my actual original catalog, that has got multiple drives, multiple folders, and multiple files, which are spanning over last, since 2006 onwards, they are there. Now, when I go and select all the files, they get selected through the folders. So I can select one file. This is in C drive. This is in D drive. This is in E drive. This is in F drive. And then when I select all this and then this, you know, I say that I want to delete, it will give you the same dialog box. Do you want to remove from Lightroom or do you from delete from disk? So if I choose delete from disk, it will delete these files individually from those folders. So if you want to delete multiple folders, Lightroom is pretty easy software to do that. But remember, when you're deleting files, you are deleting actual files. So your original files will go along with it. So if you really want to delete them, then that's the best way of doing it. But if you want to just remove them from the Lightroom catalog, I don't know why you want to remove them, because advantage of having them in the Lightroom catalog is always you can access them, you can manipulate them, you can move them from one place to another. So there is no harm in having a file inside the Lightroom catalog. And just because you have worked on that and after some time you get bored of that particular file, you just move it to one of the folders and just leave it there. You don't have to remove from Lightroom catalog. The Lightroom catalog doesn't get bogged down by photos which are there inside the catalog. You can have more than, you know, few lakh photographs and still your catalog will remain exactly as it's supposed to be. So I hope I have answered that question. If you have any doubt, you can ask. Got the idea? Yes, great. Great. Now, one of the most important thing you have to do every day, this is very important. If you are using Lightroom, every day you save your backup file of your catalog. Now, by default, every week, Lightroom, when you close the particular Lightroom, after a week, it will tell you that it's going to backup. What it basically does is it just backs up into a folder called backup file. There'll be the Lightroom catalog. But unfortunately, it backs up just next to the actual catalog. So suppose your catalog is in D drive under Lightroom. Let me show you how it is. Let me go back to my... So this is my LR catalog. This is my original catalog. And this has around 8 lakh files. And you can see the size. It's only about 1.74 GB. Not very big file. Now, if I go into backup, so what it has done, I mean, I have deleted older backups because I backed up to my external drive. So it just creates one small zip file of that particular catalog. And when you zip it, it will become very small. So for example, my 1.7 GB original file, when it zipped, it came down to about 570 MB. So that's my catalog, which was backed up on 19th, that is 4 days back. So this is what it does every week. But this just... does it just next to the catalog file. So if this drive, particular drive, get damaged, my original catalog goes, my backup catalog also goes. So what I usually do is I back it up to an external site where this is stored. So I can also send it to an external place. For example, I can send it to a cloud. I can send it to a Google Drive. I can mail myself to a Google Drive. And I can save it there. So that is the advantage of having this particular backup in several places. So always, always backup. One more question. Okay, after processing an image and exporting, is there any way to export to a different dimension in a single click? If you are using the latest version of Lightroom, it is possible. It's a single click. You can export it to multiple formats. Let me show you. Let me come back to this particular. Unfortunately, each time I change my share, the mouse annotation goes off. So let's say that I want to export this particular photograph in different formats. So let me export it. So when I'm exporting, let it, you have to create different presets. And one, just let me, that's my dog. She just wanted to be part of the Zoom seminar. So she came inside. Okay, now coming to this user presets. So just give me a minute. New preset, printing. So for printing, I will do this and rename this, save this as print. Then for Facebook, usually what I do is I have 80%. And then size, I resize the long edge to 1000 pixel. I add this preset. I usually call this as social media preset and create it. So now your question is, how do I export it to various formats? Now, assuming that you created several different presets as far as the export is concerned, you can choose all these presets at a time, tick them together, and then say export. So what it does is it will export it one to a full size, another to 1000 pixel. So I can say I choose, let's say this desktop, I created a folder called webinar, select same folder. Now it is exported. Now if I go back to that particular folder and want to see, let me show you. Now you have two different dimensions. So this is for the print. This has got a full size, and this is for the social media. So social media one has 1000 pixels, the longer side, and the print will be the full size version. Let me come back to. So that way you can export it to multiple medias. So this particular option came only in the most recent version of Lightroom, which came in 2020. So if you have an older version of Lightroom, that doesn't have that particular option. Okay, how did you open the preset folder? No, I didn't open a preset folder. A preset is just, okay, what is the question? I think, Rohit, how did you open the preset folder? Are you talking about the preset folder? Can you clarify that particular point? I'm not getting the exact question what you wanted. This is the latest version of Lightroom. This is, I think, 9.3.1 version. 9.2.1, sorry. You can create presets anywhere. So for example, your library preset, you can create it. For example, if you have done an import and you want to create a preset, so you go into the import dialog box and then do all the setup. At the end, you create a preset here. You save this current setting as a new preset. You give a name, so you have a preset created. You go under any of the settings, for example, in develop module, if you do any of the settings, I'll cover that, you know, in the next webinar. But basically, you create, go under the preset, create a preset. So it will take up all the stuff what you have created for that particular session and creates a preset. So making a preset is very, very easy in Lightroom. And I insist that, you know, whenever you try to do more than one or two steps for a particular routine, then you create preset. That's the best way. Yeah. Rohit, you are working by creating social media and printing presets. Yes. In export, when I go, I'm adding those different presets. So all those presets I can create, and then I can just tick them and ask it to export at a time. So it'll export all the different presets that I've created, and it'll apply those presets and it'll export those particular files. So that's the advantage of Lightroom. And you can have the whole workflow created into a fantastic manner using that. Now, coming back to Dheeraj's question. So Dheeraj had asked this particular question, telling that, let me read that particular question. One minute, just hold on. Is Dheeraj online? I think he hasn't joined. Anyway, we'll see if there is thing. His doubt was, all my raw files are saved on my external hard disk and are imported from there into the Lightroom, say hard drive A. I also backup my raw files on another hard drive B. The problem is I cannot edit my pictures if I use back. What if the hard drive A crashes? How do I continue the new hard drive? This is a good question. I'll answer, Murli, your question later, why DNG is important. Before that, I'll answer Dheeraj's question. Now, when you're working inside Lightroom, you're basically working on a preview, not exactly working on an original folder. But as soon as you do some changes, that particular change is applied to original folder and the original file, and then the preview is recreated. So this is how Lightroom really works. So if I actually go there and delete the files, for example, if I open this particular folder into, let me see where this particular file is. So I can click on this and right click, and then say show in Explorer. It will open up Explorer and show me that particular file. You won't be able to see because I haven't shared the application. So let me go there. So I'm actually, let me share that particular. So this is the folder where that particular file is there. So let me do one thing. Let me rename this whole folder into Curfew Capture Old. I've just renamed the folder. This is as good as deleting that particular file. So now let me come back to my screen. Okay. Now when I go into the file, if you see at the top, the photo is missing. So I will be able to see the photograph, but I won't be able to develop this particular photo. I can't do any of the development options. So if I try to do any of them, then it'll start giving error. Now, in this case, it is showing me the preview of the file, but it's not going to show me the actual development. Now, let me tell you what really happened. In the catalog, it has been mentioned that the file should be under the curfew capture. Now I have renamed the file folder as a curfew capture oldest, and it is still looking at curfew. So question mark is gone. So I can edit those files and I can do whatever. So that's the advantage of using missing folder. Now, in case of Dheeraj's question, when he connected that particular external hard disk, it would assign one letter. For example, it would have assigned the hard disk A. Inside Windows, it would have probably given F drive. So when he connected the G drive, which is a clone of that particular hard disk, it will give a different drive letter. Now all you have to do is, if Lightroom thinks that the photo is missing, all you have to go for that question mark, click on that, find missing folder, and give a new drive letter, whatever Windows has given. That particular drive letter he has to give. So with that, everything will be okay and he'll be able to edit it. So it doesn't matter which drive letter or where it is. So if you have moved this particular file to another place, all you have to do is just have to, now if I go back there and rename that as a curfew capture back, remove that old particular thing from there and rename it again, what really happens is here again you will get a question mark because see, I have renamed from curfew. So all I have to go back is find missing folder, point it out where that particular folder is missing, and then redirect it to a newer folder where the rename is taking place. So if you do anything outside Lightroom, in Explorer or in anywhere else, so usually what happens is the Lightroom will not know that. So that's the whole story of how to really manage your Lightroom catalog. Murli has asked, what's the use of copy as a DNG field? Now, DNG, when you're importing, you get an option called copy as a DNG file. So this particular option, copy as a DNG file, what it does is it copies a file as a DNG file. DNG is a digital negative file, which is a proprietary format of Adobe. Adobe had the idea of, because Canon produces its own RAW file as a CR2, CR3 files. Nikon has its own NEF files, and Sony has Sony files. So on. I mean, each RAW file is different. So it wanted to incorporate under one heading called DNG files, where it will be dragging all those different RAW files into another proprietary format, which, even though it's proprietary to Adobe, it has given up specifications, and any company which wants to use that particular DNG format, it can be used. When it really thought about these DNG files, they assumed that all other companies, all other softwares will start adopting it and using it. As of now, DNG files is used only with Adobe. So if you are shifting from, say, Lightroom to to Luminar, or Lightroom to Capture One, any of those softwares, I suggest you don't use it as a DNG file. DNG file has its own advantage. If you want to send your file after developing to somebody else to do the work, you can't send it as a RAW file. There are two ways of sending a file. One is sending as a catalog file, export the whole catalog with those files and send it to somebody else, or you can convert them into a DNG file and send it to question and answer session. So I don't want to repeat those things which I've already covered in the question and answer session. So hopefully everybody's happy. So if you have any questions, you can unmute your mic and ask vocally. Otherwise, you can write it in the chat. So it's almost about 1 hour, 15 minutes. I think we can wind up the session. So if you have any questions, please do ask. So if you have any, I'll be publishing this as a YouTube video. So if you have missed any of the first few sessions, you can listen to that. Any questions? I can hear a few voices here. There is no question. I think we can call it a day. Thank you for attending. So give me a suggestion what topics to cover in our next webinar on next Saturday.